Now, without further ado, I want to introduce the first poet who's listed here as being the translator of Homer. In fact, Christopher Logue has made an account of several books of Homer's epics with a brilliant rewriting, which most translation is, but in order for people who are pedantic about the word translation and worry about whether it's literal or an imitation or a version, his is called An Account of the Several Books of Homer He Has Translated. However, he's going to read today from his other poetry, his original poetry. He's one of the finest poets in Britain. He's been a tremendous inspiration to most of the New Departures movement and also to the oral verse movement, poetry performance movement, and political poetry. In fact, he was an inventor and originator of all sorts of things that now seem to have always been with us, but I can tell you in the zero weather years for poetry, when we started New Departures, the late 50s, there was virtually nothing. There had been Dylan Thomas, the Sitwells had tried, we heard rumours of things in Russia, there was the Beat Generation in America. But Christopher, along with Adrian Mitchell and a few others, was the only voice in the wilderness of poetry that actually got out of books and libraries and universities. So warm welcome, please, to somebody who also is publishing his memoirs shortly, a book called Prince Charming. So look out for that from Faber's in a month or two. Please welcome Christopher Logue.
Thank you very much. I'm going to read from a poem called New Numbers. The poem is not complete, and it doesn't have a narrative. What it is, it's a set of verses put together of different length, which form a sort of collage. And having said there's no narrative, well, there is a sort of subliminal narrative. Voices recur and themes recur here and there. But, so I'm going to hop around inside the collage. The poem is called New Numbers, and it begins with a short passage of prose. New Numbers. Comrades, let's face it. Poetry as bad as this has not been seen in England since the 17th century. A little more time, a little more patience, might have removed the worst of its faults, but the poet was well over 60. Nine completely naked girls will dance all Sunday afternoon on the tomb of the unknown conscientious objector. In keeping with tradition, their profitable mounds will be close shaved. There will, however, be no posing. Goose flesh will rise to sumptuous music, a melody of favourites played by the Palace of Westminster Steel Band. At three, a blind war hero will leap onto the plinth and scream, "God will forgive us all!" The naked girls will trample him to death. High in the freezing summer air, 16 smiling constables will spray hallucinatory vapors on the crowd from US Army helicopters. And when these boisterous bead their flesh, troubled enthusiasts will eat each other raw. At five, the people's candidate, hot from the loss of his deposit in the East, will seize the microphone. His theme, council housing for child murderers, a beginning. Next day, a racist scholar will demand increased grants for the parents of the dead. A spastic faints outside the National Gallery. Night falls. The sky is full of weeping reds. Sodium lozenges. A car pulls in. Half-parted silver lips. The hose. You going far? Not far. I have to drive a ten. I have to drive a friend to town. Good girl. Cannon the bonnet over two slow lanes. Headlines. Too faint at funeral of snake. Zen monk discovered in Dusseldorf sewer. Sports hero swallows oil slick. Famous idiot joins cabinet. Big rise for secret police. Fiji vanishes. Censor praises ignorance. All mountaintops occupied. Bedroom frolics after parsnip wine. Self-deception, the facts. Producer condemns playwright to death, quote, without taking the cigar from his mouth, unquote. Blake seen over London Airport. Last horse dies. Funeral poorly attended. Now and again a plane flies overhead. Sunset on tinted glass. Lit pinnacles. She steps through the warmth of exhaust pipes. Bliss, bliss to see the light, light fall from heaven through your fair, and bliss to see your white breasts pour. Light, light, fall on. Dear son, I went down to the hospital and all they said was, well, when we're your age, the pain will be the same. So that is that. I cannot knit. A policeman is walking from London to Glasgow. His handkerchief is wet with tears. And as he walks, he cries, I do not want to be cremated when I die. I do not want to be buried in consecrated ground. I want to be buried under the M1, where the traffic never stops, that those who drive this way can say, round about here, a policeman is buried. He died of love. Three criminals were driving up to town in a stolen car. As they passed the policeman, the first one shouted, goodbye, father. And the second shouted, goodbye, mother. And the third one shouted, goodbye, my love. Being in Italy, she thinks of France. You have my number. I must go. Remember me. And thank you for the dance. You are accused? Shut up, you poof, you fucking poof to poof. You are, all right, I fuck you, poof to fuck. You understand? That is the answer. Fuck you, yes, you. I fuck you too. Fuck England. Fuck America. Shall we assume he pleads not guilty? Fuck you too. Ask him again. Poof, ask yourself. Ask him. Bastard, 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 poof. Seeing these things, he dropped his shorts, shat in his hands, and frightening off his guards with it, stepped from his shorts and strode with hands outstretched towards the magistrate, demanding to be treated with respect, demanded to be given the VC. Rain in September, in Tuscany. Would you believe it? Here is my poem. Watch out, you toads. Her Majesty the Volkswagen is coming. Will your work help a body hoe their row? Is your book a good book to have when you are alone in hospital in a foreign country? Gunfire disturbs the dawn. helmeted men examine lengths of tangled hose. You must forgive this being tight, by Christopher. How I should love to see you all, but I can picture you from where from our table we could see all Malaga. Now, Carmen dear, I must stop writing. It pains my arm and takes about an hour to go away. My prayers are yours, your English mother for a little while, and for all time, your friend. Boy, clear your plate. Believe you me, you will not leave this table till you do. Roadblocks around the city. Bowsers on runways. Last night, as I lay waiting at the verge of sleep, I saw an angel lift her hand towards a drape, gather its fall aside, then beckon me forwards with her head. There, in full sunlight, the Atlantic lay, a liner in its midst. And on the liner's afterdeck, dressed in a linen suit with canvas-topped shoes, T.S. Eliot, reading, smiling. I am fed up with you. You say you love me, but you do not come. Yet you complain, I have another man. I do not have another man. I sleep around because I hate to sleep alone. Sleeping alone means that I do not sleep or pills. So do not act the jealous boy. Come now, at once, today. We will do this. Traveling, we help those who need help, but ask for nothing in return. Children whose files are inches thick, impatient men who cannot change a wheel, still traveling on and on until we die. A Greek who made millions in shipping is walking alone by the sea. It is autumn, near sunset. The wind has died down. Raising his eyes from his white basket weave shoes, he sees a boat come gliding in on two bright foils, its blue patrol lamp flashing. And in the wheelhouse of the boat, a man in uniform is singing what the Greek will later describe as a song of great beauty, not sad. Listen to what the millionaire said. I will give you the earth if you sing it again. And the man said, I will, if you sail with me. Morale being low, a decision was made for a cargo of whores to be sent to the troops, but it sank in a fog on the rocks, and the women, none of them young, were drowned. So for more than a week, their bodies were seen by the soldiers, sometimes in clusters, sometimes alone, their peroxide hair spread out on the waves. I loathe your corpse. Of course I was polite. Now I am not. Pick if you must, fight with yourself. But do not turn your nastiness on me. What is this home you say I must come home to? I have no home. You come to me, you understand? You come to me. Because of you, I left my jacket and my camera in the post office. The city dreams around you. Tall red waves with faces in their crests collapse among the tower blocks. The faces are the faces of your friends. One lifts his hat to you and says, remember us. Then they are gone. The sky is crowded with colossal masks, much like those faces drawn in chalk that drift from left to right across your dark as you lie waiting on the verge of sleep. Thank you.
Christopher Logue. Look out for his translations from Homer, his accounts of Homer, not translations, and his books, New Numbers and Selected Poems from Faber,